Hey, everybody. Welcome back to the show. This is Catherine Spires. And first up, the Smart Mouth Business Hour. I want you to know that there's Smart Mouth merch available now. You can find it at smartmouthpodcast.com. And there is also a link in the show notes. Smart Mouth has a Patreon, too. That is at patreon.com/smartmouthpodcast. And you can contribute just $1 a month, 25 cents an episode. Seems like a pretty good deal. A link to that is also in the show notes, along with a link to the newsletter at smartmouth.substack.com. Hey, are you all familiar with cork? It's a dairy product. It's super popular in Europe and in Central Asia. Technically, it's a soft cheese, but it more closely resembles a really thick yogurt. You can eat cork plain. I think it makes a great breakfast. It's super filling, and it has up to 24 grams of protein in every 8 ounces, hence the fillingness. It also doesn't separate when it gets hot, so you can use it in cooking and baking. A brand called Wunder is bringing quark to the U.S. So if you would like to try quark, go to wundercreamery.com. That's W-U-N-D-E-R creamery. And enter code SMARTMOUTH, all one word, for 15% off on your first order. That's wundercreamery.com. Use code SMARTMOUTH. Now it's time for the show. One quick note before we do, though. I don't want anyone to think that I'm kidding with the outro song choice. It is a song that genuinely makes me cry. Hey, everybody, this is Smart Mouth, and this week my guest is Jules Chambers of all things Iceland, which I'm going to call a media empire. Jules, do you think that that's accurate?
That's amazing. I will take it. I would say that if that does accurately describe what I do, that's awesome. I had no idea that I was capable. So let's just keep that energy coming.
Yes,
and
yes.
Let it manifest out into the world. Yes,
yeah.
I'll take it.
I think that's a great idea because I don't remember how I found you, but I know it's Instagram. And then it turns out that like you also do a podcast and like you're on YouTube and all this stuff. So as far as I'm concerned, that's an empire. Why not?
I like your way of thinking.
I realized that you do these weekly news roundups of just news that's going on in Iceland. And I, as I told you already, like tried to copy you. I just don't have the fortitude to do this every week. How do you do it?
It is work. I'll definitely say that. And it's not, you know, any paid. I don't have any promotion coming from it. It was purely something that I thought of out of like just a creative moment, being like, okay, you know, I want to be more on stories. So what can I talk about that might be interesting? And this was an experiment. It wasn't like I knew people would be interested in this. And I was very surprised that people were like, thank you so much for, you know, talking about the news and doing it in a short snippet type of way and writing the text and everything. And also Icelanders have been watching this and they're like, you know what? I actually like watching your news stories and the news on television. Which I'm not saying that all Icelanders do. It's not like I'm, you know, got the nation at my fingertips every week or something. But it is one of those like really nice compliments to hear that other people find it not only useful, but entertaining to watch. And like these bite-sized news, you know, stories about Iceland are keeping people who are foreigners and Icelanders up to breast, you know, with what's happening in the world here,
yeah.
The small world.
Yeah, that's so amazing. That sounds fun. So you're not someone who's naturally like you didn't grow up dreaming of Iceland, correct?
No. Like, and if someone had told me 10 years ago that I would be in Iceland, living, talking solely about Iceland all the time, then I'd be like, no. First of all, why would I even want to do something like that? And of all the places to pick to go, like I see myself as a warm weather person in my heart, you know, like my body also sees this, but in my brain and my heart has grown, of course, to really love and appreciate Iceland. Like I've fallen in love with it. But my brain, you know, just was like so stimulated by this culture and by my husband's Icelandic. So that's where I got my introduction. But in fact, actually, that's not true. My first introduction, real like meeting an Icelander for the first time, was in college with a mutual friend of my husband and I's before we met. And he's this person is how we met. So Orre was going to the same school as me and we met at a party and he, you know, was Icelandic and he showed me a book of Icelandic and I laughed so hard because I was just like, what is this? People can't actually read this. This is a joke, right? Like, this is, and I closed the book and I said to myself, there's no way that I would ever, you know, try and attempt something like that. And now I'm learning Icelandic, you know, talking in and something that I was just like, never say never.
Yeah, that is crazy. And I also, like, it's funny. I can actually, I feel like I recognize this a little bit because way bigger to move to Iceland. I moved to LA because of a boy. And the relationship didn't ultimately work out, but I'm still like, I feel like an Angelino. And, yeah. But there's a part of me that's like a little embarrassed that it was a boy that was my introduction to something new.
Yeah. I mean, it's, you just never know, right? Sometimes the universe gives you these paths and it doesn't have to be that it was based only on him, right? Because you didn't have to stay there. You could have just felt like this place doesn't fit me. I got to go. But you got this kind of, you know, conductor in a way, like getting you to
true
LA, and it's like, yeah, but this actually is where I'm supposed to be, or this is where I feel at home. So
yeah,
I kind of see it that way.
Okay, I like that. I like that a lot. So I think sometimes about the difference between like expat and immigrant and how they're the same thing, except for that if you say you're an expat, you get to belong to fancy clubs. That's like basically my understanding from having distant relatives and family friends who were expats, and they're always in like the American Women's Club and things like that. I feel like the difference is just financial, but you, I think, really split the difference because you're interested in what it means to be like a newcomer to a country and you really explore what that means.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, it has been a topic that I didn't think about until I started to talk to other people about you mentioning social economic status. And I was like, oh, wow, yeah, there is this status that's associated with expat. And at the same time, though, like I'm part of groups that are like people of color who are expat groups, right? So it's just in our own way, I think a lot of people interpret the word differently. And I just took it as like, I'm not from here. I want to distinguish that I'm not from here and just, you know, make people understand that like I'm learning and sharing kind of the same way I would if I were to do with my family and friends. So I only have ever used that word solely just because that was, I guess, what I thought felt like appropriate because I'm, you know, a United States citizen and I'm ex that. Right? So it's just like, and in reality, like, I felt like, even though it was not planned, I did move in 2016, but before the election. And so it was like, oh, yeah, I'm definitely ex. I'm ex and out of here, right?
Yes. You
know? So it was just in a lot of ways that the way that I interpreted it had more to do with that. But I'm realizing my privilege in that regard of like, I didn't have to move here. Right. There wasn't anything that forced me out of where I was living. And I feel like there's nothing to be ashamed of if you're an immigrant. There's nothing to be ashamed of if you needed to leave your circumstance to go somewhere else in order to have a better life for yourself. And maybe we need to start interchangeably using those words so that we can make them both elevated in a way that is appropriate and makes people feel like they belong.
Yeah, I like that a lot. And it's also funny, I didn't realize the timing of when you had moved. But I was in Germany in 2017, walking down the street with my mom, and this German man started screaming at us for voting for Trump. And I was like, I don't know how to, like, I don't want to engage with you, but also I don't know how to convince someone that not all Americans voted for Trump. I don't know what it looks like from the outside.
Yeah, I think they do think of it's like a popular vote thing, because a lot of people don't know the system, which is a messed up system anyway.
Yes.
So, yeah. Yeah, I'm sorry that happened to you.
Yeah, no, it was, I mean, it's not the worst thing that's ever happened, but it actually is kind of funny because I remember traveling when George W. Bush was president and being like, do we say we're Canadian? Because this is so humiliating. But compared to now, it's like, that was cute. Like, that was fine. We were just telling little lies. And like, during Trump, it was like, yikes, this is actually a bad situation.
It's way too blatant. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is weird when you start to appreciate George W. Bush.
Isn't that the darndest thing? I learned something, though, about, at least I didn't double check this, but I think it's true. So you know that whole trope about George W. Bush and Michelle Obama being best friends?
Yeah, that's really odd. Okay. Is there something new and bad? Okay.
So there's something that I heard. Again, I didn't look this up. I'm sure someone can tell me if it's true or not. That at public events that all former presidents and first ladies go to, the Secret Service actually seats them in order of past president with their first ladies next to them. So because Obama came after George W., Michelle sits in between them. So they're forced to sit together. I mean, it looks like they do enjoy each other's company, but it actually comes from like the seating arrangement that they have to abide by.
Mm, yeah. Okay. That's really interesting. And you know what? I mean, she's a very charismatic person. And I think being cordial with somebody, like laughing at something or whatever else, like, I think the internet made a big deal out of it, as if, you know, she was being a traitor to the nation or something by being friendly with this guy. Who, I mean, I'm not going to say that I personally would like to be in that situation, because I have lots of feels about the things that he did in his administration and the lives that they ruined.
Yes.
But at the same time, you know, I don't know how, I've never been in that realm, right? Where you've got this type of like attitudes and you have to shrug a lot of stuff aside in order to kind of keep within this circle of, you know, yeah, individuals that are really powerful.
And I imagine if you're a politician, or not officially a politician, but I would say that Michelle Obama is a stateswoman, a statesperson.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. If that's your regular life, you probably kind of forget about, I don't know, genocide and stuff. Like, you probably kind of have to, honestly.
It sounds horrible, but it's true, right? It's just like, this is why the presidents go so gray. Like,
yes,
the amount of stress, and then, like, their wives as well having to put on a happy face. This is what's so messed up about, like, this dynamic of first lady and whatever else. It's just like, make us feel good about the fact that, like, you know, you're really good at gardening and dressing up and, you know, making your husband look softer because he's doing things that are atrocious in probably, you know, other parts of the world, and in things that are happening, decisions that are happening, that he's changing so much because he's getting information that is just horrifying and making decisions that are always, I think almost probably every day, life or death,
yeah,
related.
Yeah. And I would say I do not have any forgiveness in my heart for Melania Trump. Terrible person through and through. However, yeah, I do think that if she, that's like a memo that she missed, and she thought she could still be her like Upper East Side or wherever, mm-hmm, New York herself. I think that if she weren't the first lady, people might have thought her Christmas decorations were like interesting, like not warm.
Yeah.
But like, yeah, if you're not the first lady, you can just do whatever artsy shit you want to do.
Yeah.
I just want to clarify again, though, that I don't like her.
It's like, this is not in defense of her.
But yeah.
Like, yeah, I mean, the whole Trump administration didn't know what they were stepping into. That's obvious.
Yes.
And at the same time, that worked to their advantage in some weird way. You know, I just, the whole thing I don't really understand, to be honest, meaning like I just don't associate, or like I can't understand how people associate themselves with that and can say like, oh, I don't care that he's basically a jerk and says the most horrible things, does horrible things. It's that he's very strong about it and he's very sure of himself. And it's like, he's not sure of himself. He literally contradicts himself every day.
Yes. So, like, he has no idea what's happening.
Yeah. And so like the Melania and all of the adults in this situation are guilty of colluding. And of course, you know, the Giulianis of the world.
Right.
Oh my goodness. Like,
so many terrible people. Have you had to spend a lot of time explaining to Icelandic people what all's going on, what has been going on?
Yeah, I have to laugh at this. Yes. And it is something that I actively avoid if I can, because it does become a burden. You know, I was in office when Trump was elected, and I was the only American in the office. So that was, and I mean like from North America, period. Canada, United States, Mexico, like there was nobody else. It was like, you know, there were other foreigners from like the UK and stuff who were English speaking. So it really fell on me in terms of people feeling like, I don't understand why would people vote for him? Did you vote for him? And I was like, no, of course I didn't. You know, like of all the people who you would think, like, would you really think I would? And so it's like trying to explain it because my mind was blown. I woke up that day seeing the news and cried. Right. There was like a lot of emotion. So, and I remember thinking to myself, I don't want to go into work today. This is not something I want to have to deal with. And I knew, but I needed to go in. And I knew that at lunchtime, which I tried to avoid too, that people were just going to be like swarming and be like, can I ask you a question?
I don't know that much about Icelandic culture. In my head, I have this idea that it's very small and that maybe the culture is a monolith. And so I'm wondering if that is accurate, and if so, if that made it harder to describe America because like the basis of it is so different.
Yeah, I would say, okay, so just even the way the government is set up is different here. So parliament is made up of different parties, meaning there isn't like in the United States where there's a two-party system where it's the everybody just votes for those two. And it doesn't seem to be any room or any possibility for other parties. That is not the case in Iceland. Like, you can't just get away with that. They actually make it so that coalitions have to work together. Different parties have to work together. And there can't be one majority party. So, like, it can't be that, you know, Republicans have the Senate and have, you know, or like, basically have Congress or something, even though things have changed now. Like, that's just obviously leading to more corruption, because there is corruption in Iceland. Like, let's, you know, be for real in terms of, that was something I had to kind of really take off my rose-colored glasses, because I had them on when I came here. I was like, yeah, Iceland's so great. And everybody wants everyone to be, you know, happy. And there's like social welfare and like, you know, caring about people. You don't have to pay so much for healthcare and blah, blah, blah. But in reality, there are very, very wealthy people here. And they're the small percentage of people, like 1%. Granted, there's still a middle class, but there are people who are living in poverty. And that's something that has been, you know, work of the unions here, of like getting people who are working poor to have livable wages. It blew my mind when I found out about this a couple of years ago at a protest. And I was like, wait, how much are they making a month? And they're working full time? This is insane. Like, how does anybody live off of this amount of money? So anyway, in terms of the government, though, there is a difference there. So I think like new parties, like the Pirate Party, which kind of sounds ridiculous, but like, but they are more like socially aware and way more liberal than anything that would ever be accepted in the United States. Like, that's, you know, and it's not more just like social welfare. It's more like this one person proposed a bill or changed to a bill where like, why can't four people adopt a child? You know, like, it's just, it's one of those things where it's like, logistically, how does this work? I don't know. But it also like brings to question, how does our society reflect how people are evolving, right? And like in the US, that person would be laughed out of the room. They would not be in the government and be like, no, you're crazy. That's like in opposition to our traditions as Americans. I don't know. As if like, is this like this whole idea of like Americans mean that only certain types of people get married or can adopt a child? Like, it's just really strange when you are coming from the outside now. So, but the U.S. still, because of people being aware of like how big it is and the influence it has, people are still somewhat like keeping up to date with it. The news in Iceland always has news from the United States and around Europe and things like that, purposefully. Like, it's filled with news from Iceland and news from outside because it plays such a big role. And also, there's not as much news, I think, to keep things probably interesting always in Iceland, to be honest. So yeah, there is an awareness, but there isn't always a deep understanding of it unless they've lived in the US and had to kind of like integrate and understand, or, you know, maybe that's just their home now, so they have a better understanding of it, you know? So it really varies on the person, but the majority of Icelanders haven't lived in the US. So their idea of it is media-based, like many places, which can be very detrimental because then it's like you have the same type of like idealism about the US that others have. But that's changed with Trump, for sure.
Speaking of education, I remember growing up very specifically being told that Greenland and Iceland essentially have the names that the other one should have, because Greenland is all ice and Iceland actually does have flora and fauna. Is that true?
Well, both of them have flora and fauna. Greenland is just like the majority. There's a like so much larger amounts of ice. So I had the pleasure and I was very fortunate to go to Greenland a few years ago. And I was there for 9 days in the summertime, and it was for work. So, you know, even though I was there for work, I was like, wow, this is amazing. Yeah. Like, I'll take it. Like, yeah. This is so cool. And if for anybody who comes to Iceland, you can easily get to Greenland in 3 hours from Iceland. So that's like it's a hub to that in Denmark, because Denmark owns Greenland. So in Greenland in the summer, beautiful. Like, it's just, it's very, very rugged, though. When you're watching like out of the airplane at the mountains are even more rugged than in Iceland. And it's just like, it's insane how beautiful it is. When you are on the ground, though, which is an interesting fact, is that, I mean, there's stuff that's growing. There's not as much depending on where you are, but we were definitely, we went on a trek for 4 days, and we were out there in lots of green fields and different flowers. And, you know, we, the tour guide had a rifle just in case a polar bear showed up. You know, so it's like, it's real raw. Like, I've not had to experience that in Iceland going hiking in the highlands. Like, you're not afraid of a polar bear. No one's got a rifle. So, like, but it just depends on the season. So it's way harsher in Greenland in the wintertime because it's in the Arctic Circle. Whereas, like, Iceland is only a small piece in the north, where if that's part of the Arctic Circle. So you'll come here in winter, but it won't be green. It will, like, you know, look like things are hibernating and waiting for summer to come. But I think Greenland has like 85% ice or something. It's like, don't quote me on that, but it's a large amount. Whereas like Iceland is 11% of the country has like these glaciers, which are receding, unfortunately. And so you end up finding that, yeah, it's true that Greenland, technically, it would be smarter to name it Iceland because it has way more ice. But it's not like nothing ever grows there. You know, it's just depending on the season, which just only the warm season is when you're going to be able to actually see and appreciate that part. Otherwise, you'll be on a, you know, dog sled or like ice skating or something across a fjord.
Okay, I'm going to ask you a question that, like, seems stupid on its surface.
Okay.
How are you a vegan in this kind of climate? P.S. I understand, like, importing and canned goods and all that kind of stuff, but, like, it does seem particularly complicated to be a vegan in a place that doesn't necessarily have an abundance. Like, in California, it's easy to be a vegan. We grow everything there. How do you do it?
Yeah, I mean, I would love to have the access to, like, the stuff you have in California. That's amazing. Okay, so when I was moving, I visited Iceland 5 or 6 times before moving. So I was aware of what was available, at least then, to me as a vegan. Because I became a vegan almost, I'm going on 6 years now. So I, you know, I've been in my relationship for 7. So I am, you know, like, in my way, I feel like I'm in my groove with being a vegan, so I really know what I need. But before, it was definitely like a figuring out process for me. But I would go to the grocery store and I was like, oh, that's here and that's here. Not like, not everything that I want, but like they're here. It's not cheap, you know, like it's not, food here in general is not cheap. But there has been a growing amount of people being vegan in this country. And it is so surprising. And now there's something called Veganuary, which I think other countries do too. It might be a European thing, where people take the pledge of being vegan, like trying it for 30 days. Or is it 31 days in January?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah,
I think.
So for all of January, basically. Yeah, I mean, I could have just said that. And it's been amazing. And I'm part of a vegan Iceland group, a Facebook group. And there are so many people that are excited about it. There's so many new things. We have a Costco that came some years ago. You know, so like there's an all-vegan store, which I actually plan to talk about in one of my YouTube videos because I just need to bring attention to the fact that, you know, veganism is thriving in Iceland. It is not difficult at all. I know the basis, like the traditional food of pickling and salting and drying and things like that. It makes sense that you would not, you know, associate veganism with Iceland, but it's become such a vegan friendly place. We went out to dinner for the first time in like the pandemic yesterday. So we've had 0 cases, I think, for like a day or so. And so we're like, okay, we're going to go out and just, you know, enjoy being in a restaurant. Like, yeah. It's really nice.
I can't even,
like,
imagine.
I miss it. I don't want to be around people, but I miss it. Like, it's coming out. No. And when we went out, I mean, this place on their website, they don't have like a set vegan menu that they tell you about. But when you call them, they're like, oh yeah, that's no problem. We can do that. And like there's even a place called Meat Reykjavik. And they have vegan options. Okay. Like, and I was just like, and the only reason why I know this, because this story always baffles me when I think about it, is my mother-in-law was turning 70 last May. And we were trying to find, like, they were trying to find a place of like where we could all go eat. And they know that I'm vegan. And like my sister-in-law's partner at the time is keto. I mean, they're not together anymore, but whatever. So there was like these different diet needs. And they called the place and they're like, yeah, we can do both of those. That's no problem. And I, when they told me we're going to meet Reykjavik, I was like, do you not want me to go? You can just like, you know, you can tell me. That's okay. And they're like, no. We checked. They have vegan food. And I was like, this is going to be ridiculous. It's probably going to be like, here, eat some salad. You know, like it's like not well thought out food, but it was really good. And that was one of the best desserts I've had in a restaurant because it was not just sorbet with nuts, you know, because that's normally what it is. It's like just giving them the ice cream that people who are lactose intolerant get normally. It was like a delicious chocolate whatever. And I was like, wow. This was, I want to come back here. This is good. Like, I'm about to recommend meat Reykjavik to vegans. You know, like, what is going on? So, it's so vegan friendly. It's insane.
I wonder if people work harder at it because it's more difficult. Like, you have to put more thought into it.
Maybe. I just think also, too, Icelanders are really big on trends. And they love to hop on a trend. Like, and more, like, veganism is not a trend anymore here. It's, like, people's lifestyles. But they're also noticing that around the world, people are requesting this when they were coming, you know. So it's like being prepared for the different types of people because Iceland depends so much on tourism that it's like we need to cater to a lot of different things. And like you mentioned, though, it is kind of difficult. So I think doing it well sets you apart because it is easy just to be like, I'm going to roast some vegetables and throw it on a plate and good luck, right? Enjoy yourself. And it's like, no. There's, you know, we like to eat well. We like to enjoy different flavors and combining things that are maybe unusual. And at the place we went to last night, they had like pomegranates and different things in there that I was not expecting.
Man, I would be such a failure as a vegan. I would be such a Doritos vegan. Like it would not be a healthy situation for me. I just like starches so much. But the thing about it actually like kind of made me laugh when you were like, do you want to talk about broccoli? Just because for me, broccoli is like the vegetable that I at least try to eat almost every day. There's something about it that's just like, because I'm a child and I feel like I need to remind myself to eat my vegetables. So I'll literally eat like 3 cups of broccoli a day.
Nice. Good for you.
Yeah, but it's also incredibly boring. Like, because life is hard and busy and I don't always even season it. It's just, you know, they have enormous bags of frozen broccoli that you can buy and you can just steam them up real quick and it's easy. And I'm like, there, I have vitamins in me today. And it's not, I obviously don't dislike broccoli. I couldn't do this if I did.
Right.
But it's such a like, it's almost like a staple for me in a way that I don't necessarily think of a lot of other vegetables as being.
It's such a great vegetable for you too. I mean, like,
yeah, exactly. Amazing. It has like vitamins that not necessarily every vegetable has. And it has like some magnesium and it has vitamin K and selenium and stuff.
And potassium. Like it's just so much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So were you like a broccoli fan naturally, or is it like upon becoming a vegan you're like, okay, and broccoli is a thing that I can get into?
I don't remember as a kid wanting broccoli like that. My mom would also steam it, but I think she also oversteamed it, so it's just like limp and mushy, and it's just like, who wants to eat this? I feel like this is the punishment food on my plate or something, so I'd like put sauce on it or something and eat it, because in our house there wasn't like you leaving food behind, you just eat it. Right. You know, it's like the typical, I think, for many people of like, you can't get dessert or you can't leave the table until you finish your food, which we know now is probably not the best like
huge
way of
mistake
doing. Yeah.
One of the many ways the 80s did a number on us.
Yeah, exactly. But I think it's just my association with broccoli was like whatever until I was on Pinterest, which I'm a heavy Pinterest user. And I saw someone take broccoli, put it in a bag with some salt and something else, like oil, and like shake it up and then put it on a tray and roast it. And I was like, I like that idea. Let me try that. And so I did. And I was like, and the bag thing I realized became unnecessary and just like plastic. Like, come on. Like, it's getting to the point where it's like,
even just like when recipes are like, put it in a bowl and mix it with the oil, I'm like, nah, I'm just gonna do it on the cookie tray. This is fine.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you don't have to. Right, exactly. So I just started doing that basically and roasting broccoli, and it's so good. And that's what I like. So I have salt on it. Sometimes I put paprika. And I've got like all these different things. I'm like, oh yeah, I'm like spicing up a broccoli. And so that's what made me interested in broccoli, was that I just experimented based off of this Pinterest, pin that I saw. And then my mother-in-law also makes this delicious broccoli and cauliflower soup with like coconut milk. And oh, it's so good. And it's very filling. And I was just like, there's these different ways that you can have broccoli. So I want to just do that. And I've been doing also like this stir fry with broccoli and cashews and sesame oil, like toasted sesame oil and soy sauce. And ooh, it's like, it's so, so good. And has like good fats. And you have like the fiber from the broccoli and all the vitamins and everything. And it's just, yeah, it's very satisfying, basically. And broccoli, as you mentioned, like I like to try and eat it as much as I possibly can. I've moved a little bit into like consuming a lot of cabbage too, so I have to separate those two because it's just like gas attack, like trying to eat both of them at the same time. Yeah, and also like lot. It's just so filling. Yeah. And so it's like they're not a lot of calories, but they'll fill you up and you might realize you're not getting enough calories to sustain your energy and everything.
Yeah. Just so people don't think I'm a total animal, I am under so much pressure to have like such a sophisticated yet open-minded palate being a food writer, and I can't, I just can't always live up to it. I'm just one person. But I do
You're
like,
human.
I got like all defensive all of a sudden. Just so everyone knows, I don't always eat it steamed and plain. Sometimes you can do stuff like, they have those like miso soup packets. And if you if you steam them and have some water on them, you can kind of just do the miso packet on it, and then you can add a little chili crisp. And I actually posted a picture of it recently with like bay shrimp. I kind of made like a little miso broccoli soup out of it, but like not on purpose. It wasn't a recipe, so it's easy. Yeah. Like you don't have to think about it. Also, I really need that broccoli cauliflower coconut soup recipe.
Yeah,
please,
I will ask
you.
Her. She's one of those like, oh, you know, I just put this and I'm like,
yes.
But I'm not like that. I need instructions. So I'll ask her.
Okay.
But no guarantees.
Hey, let's talk about Quark. Specifically the cultured dairy product called Quark. It's very creamy, it's not tart at all. It's high in protein and low in lactose, and Quark is a staple in European and Central Asian diets. It's technically a soft cheese because it's made with a blend of cheese and buttermilk cultures, but Quark more closely resembles like a thick yogurt. I personally eat it like yogurt, usually for breakfast or a snack, but you can also use it like sour cream, cottage cheese, creme fraiche, things like that in either sweet or savory recipes, cold or hot. A brand called Wunder has been pioneering Quark in the US, and they make it in rural Western Pennsylvania using milk only from cows raised on small dairy farms. So if you'd like to try some Wunder Quark, go to Wunder Creamery. That is like Wunder, but with a U. Wunder Creamery. And enter code SMARTMOUTH, one word, for a 15% off discount on your first order. That's WunderCreamery.com. Use code SMARTMOUTH. Broccoli's been around for a long time, but it's not a wild plant. It doesn't grow in nature.
Okay.
I had no idea.
I didn't know that either. Yeah. I'm learning right now. It's like, oh, wow. All right. Well, is this like a GMO type of thing we're talking about?
Yes. Like it's an old style GMO. It's a 2,000-year-old GMO where wild brassicas. So it's part of the brassica family, which is the mustard family. And it includes like kohlrabi, the cauliflower, basically all your crunchy green vegetables, Brussels sprouts, kale. I didn't realize this, so I guess I call them cruciferous too. But I guess cruciferous, we're being very old-fashioned by calling it that. And now it's known as brassicas. I guess they changed it because cruciferous, if you really think about it, you can tell just by the name, it means like of the cross. Because on the mustard plant, the flowers grow, there's four of them per stem. And so they say it's like a cross shape. So they named it the cruciferous plant family.
Because
it reminded them of Jesus, which is just the way so many old-timey things are named.
Yeah, that's true.
I think they wanted to move away
from
that.
It's like how religion seeps into our lives, even in vegetables.
Exactly.
That is fascinating.
So these cruciferous or brassicas, they grow wild all over like the coastal parts of Italy, but they taste nasty, which I think like more recently.
It's like it's actually just something in it, but they taste nasty.
They do. Fact. You know, there's this constant conversation, and I'm so pedantic and I always have to be correcting people when they say like, oh, when I was growing up, like no one knew how to cook Brussels sprouts. And or there was a stereotype that Brussels sprouts were nasty, but Brussels sprouts taste so good. And it's like, no, 20 years ago, Brussels sprouts were bad. They have since grown them, developed them, cultivated them to be more sweet and less bitter.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
So, yes, we do enjoy them more because they taste different.
Yeah,
because
we actually can, like, enjoy them.
Yes. Yes, exactly. And that's totally what happened with broccoli 2,000, 3,000 years ago in all over the Mediterranean, but focused in Italy, was that they really did grow them to be sweeter than their natural state.
Okay.
And wow. In doing so, they also, like, the shape of them changed and how often they can be harvested changed. It used to only be every other year, but now you can harvest them multiple times a year. And also there's different kinds of broccoli, and the kind that grew more in Italy. I was so surprised to hear that, like, Italy is the historical home of broccoli, because I'm thinking, like, American style broccoli. And I was like, I don't really think of that. But it's the, like, more leafy kind with, like, each stem is separate and has, like, more, like, heads that kind of droop off of it.
Is it kind of like the broccolini stuff, or is it
different
than that? Okay. Although, I don't really like that broccolini.
I know, it does kind of taste different. But it's funny, they're also cultivated and they all come from the same family, so they're all siblings. Okay. Not even cousins, they're siblings. But rapini is, this is so funny, because that, I think, it's also called broccoli rapini, broccoli rabe, rapini and broccoli rabe.
Yes. Okay.
That's actually a turnip.
Oh,
yeah.
What?
That totally wigged me out too. Also, I
that's turnips, like in disguise stuff going on here. Yeah. Like, undercover turnip.
So yeah, I was talking about American versus Italian style broccoli. That's not the real term. It's heading broccoli versus sprouting broccoli. And heading broccoli is the kind that, like, we think of as Americans, and the sprouting is the, like, more exotic kind. But then, also confusingly, the heading kind, the American kind, is also called the Calabrese broccoli. That's its technical term because it comes from Calabria in Italy. Yeah. And then there's also Romanesco.
Yeah, I've heard of that. And that's super weird looking. Like,
yes.
Alien broccoli thing going on. It's really cool, though.
It's so cool. But it is, like, when I think about it too much, I kind of get, like, galaxy brain, because it is a fractal. Like, it's in the fractal shape, and then I'm like, math and vegetables and outer space, whoa.
Yeah, it's totally alien broccoli. That's what I'm going to go with.
Yeah, yeah, it is. You know what I think is the most disgusting thing? And I know that the show is not about cauliflower, but broccoli and cauliflower are often conflated. So the part of broccoli, the non-stem part, you think of, like, the dark green little circles, those are all just flower buds that haven't bloomed yet.
All right.
Cauliflower, the white part, do you know what that's called? It's called curd.
It's really? Kind of like
curd.
With cheese.
Yes.
Type of. Yeah. Interesting.
I can deal with it with dairy product, but when you call cauliflower curd, I'm like, oh, I don't know why that bums me out so much.
Maybe you think about, like, milk gone bad or something, you know?
Yeah.
Like, but in a plant form.
So nasty.
Yeah, I don't think that I needed that in my life. But thanks anyway.
I'm so sorry.
No, I'm kidding. But it is something that I will now think about when I go and see a head of cauliflower. I'm like, oh, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. And then just look away.
I can see it.
Yeah. Yeah. So broccoli is mentioned by the great Roman writers who often discussed food. There were so many different dudes named Pliny, P-L-I-N-Y. Like, there's so many of them. I've given up on, like, trying to differentiate for myself which one was which, and then also trying to define it on this show. Like, one of the dudes named Pliny, who wrote a lot and was considered very important, he talked about how much Romans loved it in the year 200-ish.
Okay.
So it was already rocking big time by then. And then before that, there was also this cookbook writer named Apicius. Talk about him all the time on this show. I love the way that my source on this framed it. Some vegetable scholars recognize broccoli in the cookbook of Apicius. And I'm like, vegetable scholar? Fun. That's my takeaway from that.
It's a thing. Right? Yeah. Like, they're probably vegetable scholars listening to this. I'm like, hey.
Yeah. Excuse me. I have a degree from Harvard.
Yeah, exactly. That's horrible that we're laughing at them, but we appreciate you, vegetable scholars.
I appreciate that. I'm laughing with the vegetable scholars. I'm laughing at Harvard. So
yeah, there you go.
So yeah, like the ancient Romans dug it, and then it kind of doesn't get talked about for a while until around the 1500s when it starts moving up into more northwestern parts of Europe. And essentially, England kind of recreated what ancient Italy had done with, like, they started figuring out, again, how to get these brassicas, or cruciferae, as they were calling them then, more sweet and growing more often. Basically, how to be a little bit more of a staple crop.
Yeah.
Side note to say that staple crops, commodity crops in America and a lot of other country really just mean, like, the grains.
Okay.
Broccoli is a specialty crop. But that doesn't mean it's fancy. I think lots of times specialty and fancy get conflated when we're talking about agriculture. But specialty basically means like any green vegetable. So it's kind of a meaningless term, I think.
Trying to make those ordinary vegetables feel special. Basically.
Oh, right? That's such a nice way of looking at it. I love that.
It's like, don't worry, we still love you. You're special in our hearts.
Yeah. I think this kind of speaks to the fact that all these vegetables were really bitter and not very beloved, is that, like, so England and France, there is the first mention, you know, contemporary mention of broccoli in the 1500s, but even in the 1700s, anytime it was written about, it still had to be described. So people weren't like hearing broccoli and knowing what it was.
Yeah.
Some of the ways it was described, though, are like, what now? Italian asparagus.
No.
I know.
Like, well, no. I'm trying to think of like maybe the broccolini, but it's like, nah.
Yeah, even that. Because even if we're thinking about like the essentially tinier version of broccoli.
And like longer stem and everything.
Yeah. It's like kind of, but it's like that's still really a stretch, and it also does not taste anything.
No.
Like that. At least not that we know of, although I just did go on a rant about how like we breed these vegetables to taste better. So who knows? Maybe it all tasted the same back then. I don't think that's true, but maybe. I hate talking about Thomas Jefferson because people are way too quick to believe that he is like the father of American agriculture. That dude didn't do shit except be rich. He did write about broccoli, though. I will say that like in 1 year when he was writing down what they had planted that year, he did mention broccoli. So, okay, fine. He knew what it was. Congrats, Thomas.
It's like, good for you.
Yeah. Anyone who's just turning in for the first time is probably like, what is her deal? But regular listeners of the show know that I have a huge problem with how he's sort of this godlike figure. And people say he brought all these delicious treats to the U.S. And please, please, everyone remember that he owned slaves and they did all the work. And he also sent them to Europe to learn how to do more work. So anything that we got from quote unquote Thomas Jefferson was absolutely the work of other people. That's my Jefferson rant for this episode.
I mean, founding fathers in general, just, you know.
Yes. Yes. It's just.
They're very privileged individuals.
Yes. They're living a different kind of lifestyle. Thomas Jefferson is the only one who ever comes up. Well, sometimes Ben Franklin, but it's like Thomas Jefferson is a regular fixture in food history.
Okay, I was unaware of that.
Yeah, so I think that's why I have such an issue with him in particular, because have to hear about him all the time, and it's always just written about, like he's so lauded for doing nothing except for being a horrible human-owning rapist. That is his legacy. Yep. Oh, true. God. Anyway, broccoli.
On to things we like.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, and then also people clearly knew more about cauliflower because like as we go further, closer to where we are now in history, people started saying, so the stems are like asparagus, but the heads are like cauliflower. So I think we're getting like closer to accuracy, but they're still
but
described.
Why know cauliflower better than broccoli? You know, like that's a...
Cauliflower just like... hit before and hit bigger.
Maybe because it's milder too?
I think so. Yeah, I think they didn't have to do as much work to make it palatable. Yeah. A lot of people still don't like cauliflower, but I think it's more like cauliflower tastes like how cauliflower tastes. They don't think they had to breed the natural flavors out of it as much. So, big deal in Southern Europe and even like kind of all around the Mediterranean. Like for a while in England, they were calling broccoli like the Cyprus flower or something because they started getting it from Cyprus. There was Syria was a big grower of it for a while in older times. Now it's kind of grown by the big agricultural powers, which usually means globally is India and China. They grow a lot of what we eat. Although living in Iceland, are you, like, my understanding is that Europe gets a lot of its produce from Africa.
Okay, so it's funny, when it gets to us, it will say like Spain or Holland or, you know what I mean? So it's like, I don't really know if everything is grown in those places or that's where it somehow got to and then got to us at some point. I'm assuming though that a lot of it is from where they're putting the label of, which is like Holland and blah, blah, blah. I think so. But like the paprika, like red bell peppers and or bell peppers in general, like those will say Spain on them, like in the grocery store.
Okay. You know, so, yeah. That makes sense. It's interesting because like, I don't know if it's the similar to in American grocery stores where some things just have the little sticker on them and some things are in like a clamshell package. And I think that the stickers always say where it was grown, at least in the U.S. But sometimes the clamshells, I think sometimes they're allowed to say where it was packaged.
Yeah. I'm not so sure about the distinction of that. Meaning, I have seen it on stickers before, but sometimes they literally just have like a little board that says Holland. You know, like it's just like written like this is where these are from. And part of that too is because Iceland does grow some things in greenhouses, but they run out very fast. So they'll grow like bell peppers and carrots, tomatoes, mushrooms. But mushrooms are the ones that are often available and salad all year. But sometimes they run out of bell peppers and something or cucumbers, whatever. And then you'll see that just from some other place.
It's so wild to think about. We live on the same planet, but you live in a country where you can run out of food because it just doesn't have like the space and the temperature to grow a lot of them. Whereas in America, when someone's hungry, it's because of like the supply chain.
Yeah. Yeah. It's political.
Yeah.
Right. It's terrible. It's just like, oh, you're hungry because you didn't pull yourself up by your bootstraps. That's why it's like, why is this even a question? Like,
I know.
No one should be hungry in this ridiculous, like filthy, wealthy country.
I know you said that there's like more individual economic diversity in Iceland than I thought there was. Are there, like, what about politically? Like in America, you're allowed to say out loud in public, well, if someone can't pay their rent, I guess they should get another job. Like you're allowed to just be like nasty and small and cold like that. Are you allowed to do that in Iceland?
You technically can say that. But the
legally.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know. It's just the backlash is going to hurt a lot. So then it would be like, no, like, are you, get another job? And there are people who do work multiple jobs, but why should they have to do that? If everyone should have a livable wage, and that's essentially what the backlash would be here, is that Icelanders and foreigners alike would be like, no, that's a terrible idea. We deserve to have our time with our families, our time by ourselves if we don't have a family, like, you shouldn't have to literally work yourself to death just to pay your bills. And that is something that I very much appreciate here. Even in my first job, I was coming in with a very New York attitude. So I was just working all the time. It was summertime, one of the best summers that Iceland had in a while. And I had no idea that summer sometimes doesn't come in Iceland, right? So I learned the hard way some years after that. But like people would leave at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I was like, What are they doing? This is ridiculous. Like, they're just leaving the office. And it's like, you have a life. The sun is out. Go enjoy it. If it's not absolutely necessary to finish that today, and if your job allows you to do this, then you can go out and enjoy it. And I was like, oh, wow. Isn't that nice? This is like, I didn't get it at first. I had to let it seep in that I'm in a culture that values people having a life. Right outside of work, your job is not the definition of your life, and that took a long time.
I believe you because I still struggle with it. I mean, I would imagine that you had a more immersive experience with it, so maybe it didn't take as long for you to come around to it. Although being someone from New York, maybe you still struggle with it.
It took a long time.
Yeah,
I still work a lot.
Right, so like I. know that I want to be Icelandic like that. You know, I'm like, that is the correct way to be a human. But at the same time, like, if I take an afternoon off, I'm like, well, I'm a real piece of shit. Like, it's so hard to make it come together.
And I don't think it's like you're saying, it's not just a New York thing. I think it's in the US. There's this whole idea that you are slacker if like every minute of your life is not dedicated to making money. Because that's essentially what we're talking about, right? Like, I love it then when artists are able to just be like, I created that and I don't care if no one sees it. And I'm like, what? You spend so much time and you're not going to get something out of it. At least from being like, that's nice. You know, it's like, no, I made this for myself. And I was like, that's really good for you. I am not there yet. Like, I would love to get to a point where I don't care. But I don't know if that will ever happen. And a part of me is okay with that. As long as what I'm doing, I feel passionate about. Because that was the other thing, is that I had to learn, like, what you're doing your podcast, right? I'm assuming this is something that you really feel passionate about. And, you know, from your research and everything, it's so fascinating to hear from you about the history of broccoli, for instance, right? Like, never thought I'd be talking about this in my life. But it's just, it makes a huge difference. It doesn't really, of course, it's work. There are plenty of things that are work. But it doesn't feel the same as when you're doing it for somebody else and they have their own expectations on you and they're, you know, setting the rules about what's appropriate or inappropriate. And you're just like, I don't like that. I don't believe that. Let me just do it my way. I want to do it the way that it express, but from my expression, that feels good.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I really go back and forth about that, though, because sometimes I wish that I had gone into a career that I didn't care about. Because I feel like then I would have an easy time being like, end of the workday, goodbye. And then everything I'm actually interested in could just be an interest rather than trying to monetize all my interests, which is what everybody my age feel like tries to do. I think it's kind of a trap. I don't know.
It is. Social media becomes your brand.
Yes.
Right? Like, you don't have, I don't even use my personal account anymore. What's the point? Like, I don't have time for it.
Yeah.
And also it's weird to say that it doesn't serve me in any way because it's like, I'm going to talk about Iceland anyway. So it's like, I might as well do it on all things Iceland. And then at the same time, like, I keep certain things private. I don't talk about everything in my life because I don't think that's necessary. But I've just felt myself morph into, okay, this is going to be about, if it's about Iceland, then it's always going to be all things Iceland. And so far, it's always Iceland. And if I go on vacation, then I'm just on vacation. I'm not posting on Instagram. And that actually is kind of freeing in some degree.
I mean, I can't even imagine. Yeah, that seems so smart since, like, I have a food-based Instagram. If I am on vacation, I am even more about taking photos of every meal. And it's so weird. And then it's also weird because I'm not, like, one of these influencers with hundreds of thousands of followers. So sometimes I'm also like, does it matter? And then I'm like, why am I one? Like, the people who enjoy my stuff. It doesn't matter if there's 5 of them or 5 million of them. Like, why is that? There's just constant buzzing in your head about whether or not what you're doing is worth anything.
Yeah, it's also kind of future-proofing to some degree too, because it's like, if you're doing it and more people do come along and want to follow you and want to do things with you, right? It's like, oh, well, I have this archive of things. So it's just like, there's this, I don't know. I mean, maybe it's purposefully done or not. Maybe we're just all part of the machine.
I think we are, essentially, but... Some people are better at being part of the machine than other people.
There's this, especially if you are already like a big influencer, content and finding things to keep people interested and getting new people to be interested in you. This is the game, right? And that's sometimes the hardest part, where I have to take a break and be like, I'm going to do it on my terms. I see other people doing really cool things and I don't want to feel like I have to outdo them and myself every time in order to keep people engaged, right? Like, I think having a podcast too, and or having like a YouTube channel and things like that, those are really helpful because people have archives of things to watch. Whereas like on Instagram or TikTok or whatever, most of the time people are just like spinning through it really, really fast. It's like, it gets old, you can't find it again. Like, it's just much harder for you to kind of feel like, oh, I can just binge on this person without having to, like, you know, go and look up stuff as much. It's just kind of there. It's just available to me or being suggested to me, especially on YouTube.
Yeah.
Right? So it's like, for people like her, going, like, finding things to keep on top, right? Like,
right.
That is, it's literally the next level of intimacy in someone's life. And that is a hard choice to make.
And yeah, then, you know. Absolutely. Although I will say with having like static content, though, is I think people will listen to or watch episodes of things way after they originally aired. I might have mentioned this before, but I just like kind of can't get over it. I got a bad review on iTunes.
Oh,
nothing
no.
to do with my food history knowledge or anything like that. It was like a really like curt review. It was something like, it quoted me and it was like, oh, I'm not all in for Joe Biden. Okay, I'm done listening to this show. And I was thinking about it and I was like, I think that you just listened to that episode where I said that, but it's something that I said a year ago.
Yeah.
And you aren't understanding that. Like,
yeah.
If you came away from that thinking that I'm pro-Trump, I'm like, yeah. Come on.
Like, yeah. Yeah, that is hard.
I think that was when Warren was still in the running. So. Mm-hmm.
Which I was also a big Warren fan. I was like, come on.
Yeah.
But in my heart of heart, I knew that it wasn't going to work out because she's not like, first of all, she's not associated with the Obama administration, which is obviously Joe Biden's biggest advantage or was his big advantage when he was running. But I think she was just too smart, too practical.
I know.
She literally had it down word for word, like dollar amount, penny amounts, like how things were going to work. And I was like, this is so smart. And it's like, America is not ready for a smart woman to literally make the right decisions and proven decisions, right? She's so highly educated in it that people were intimidated. And it's like, this is
literally,
so frustrating.
Literally the only time I ever heard Elizabeth Warren flustered was when she was on the phone with me.
Oh, okay. What did you say to her?
A blocked call. And the only people I regularly get phone calls from with blocked calls are my grandparents. So I got a blocked call and I said, hello. And the woman's voice on the other end said, Catherine. And I said, hi, Grandma.
That's perfect.
And she was like, God. What? Well, I'm not your grandmother.
Oh, my God. That is priceless. I love it. Yes, that is the best story. Grandma?
Yeah. So other than that, cool as a cucumber always, yeah, that Elizabeth
totally.
Warren.
It's like,
I really got her, though.
Yeah. It's like the one way to get Elizabeth Warren.
Yeah. I mean, I was flustered, too. I didn't know what the hell was going on.
And you're like, oh, whoa. Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
And then she would, like, we established who she was, and she was like, what policies are important to you? And I was like,
It's like, Grandma, we're getting a little too political on here right now. That
oh
is amazing. I'm going to tell that story because that is so good. I'm going to point them to you and be like, this chick has got it.
There's a woman I know who's a really talented cartoonist. Her name is Trillian Spencer. And I actually like tweeted this story out and she created this little cartoon of it. And now it's the header of my Twitter profile. If anyone wants to look
awesome.
At it,
okay.
At Catherine Spires,
check it out.
It's the most perfect visual representation of what happened in two panels. Like if you see it, you'll like get it. You're like, this is like, it's drawn so perfectly.
That's amazing. I'm going to check it out.
Anywho. Okay. So we talked about how like it was like kind of throughout the centuries, like people in Europe sort of generally knew what it was. America, it took a long time. It wasn't commercially grown in the United States until specifically like 1922. Mm. We know like there's such a specific date because it was so recent, and it was very specifically by these two brothers who were Italian immigrants. And they started growing it in California where they lived, but they shipped it to Boston where there were a lot of Italian people living.
Yeah, okay.
So they very specifically went after the Italian American market, and it like boomed after that. It took 20 years. It wasn't until after World War II that like it became broccoli as we know it, in the sense that like not exotic at all. Mm-hmm. On every dinner plate all the time. You aren't even thinking about it. So it's like less than 80 years that it's been common here. And now it is the United States is the third largest producer of broccoli in the world. 2 billion pounds of broccoli a year.
Wow.
That's so
much
broccoli.
That's all I'm thinking.
It is. Part of the reason is because it can be grown year-round in California. California produces 95% of all the broccoli grown in the U.S., but it also exports a bunch of it to Canada and Taiwan and Japan. I think this is a rare instance of us exporting an agricultural product at large.
Yeah.
I don't think we're really in that place anymore. Everything that you think of as American, like, for whatever reason, I think of peanuts as being a very American crop. We grow a minuscule amount compared to China.
Really?
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Okay. So I think that's kind of
rare. That peanut butter I consumed as a kid.
Yeah, who knows where the peanuts came from?
Yeah.
They're also, you know, constantly trying to come up with different versions of products. So there's now something called the brocca flour.
Oh, what?
Yeah. They smash together the broccoli and the cauliflower.
Why? Does it taste good? I mean,
you got to figure, like, these farmers, they have scientific brains. You couldn't be a farmer or farm worker or anything in agriculture without being sort of science brain. And you got to figure sometimes, like, I don't know, they get a little bored with the day-to-day harvesting and they're like, now what if I grafted this with this? Like, what's going to happen? And that's my official story for how that came about.
Okay. Well, I'm curious to see it. I mean, next time I go to New York, I'll in the produce aisle look to see if there's, well, I shouldn't say produce aisle, produce section, because it's like a huge area. If there's, what is it called?
Brocca flower.
Brocca flower.
Yeah.
It's sounds like a rapper's name.
It totally does.
Right? It's just like, it could be.
Yeah. It's only been around since the 80s. I don't think I've ever seen it. Although, who knows? Like, it's not like
maybe
I was looking for it.
I didn't know what I was looking at.
Yeah. Huh. Exactly. And then also, you know, I think this speaks to broccoli's universal popularity is that they've come up with tropical broccoli and cauliflower that can be grown in South Asia.
Wow.
Yeah.
Fascinating. Okay.
Yeah.
Learned
and here
lot.
We are. And I'm like, I'm not going to stop eating it. I'm still like on this broccoli journey of eating so much of it. I have to defend myself, though, and say that I think my stomach is used to it because I have no adverse effects from eating my 3 cups of broccoli a day.
It is one of those, like, you have to build up the tolerance, basically. Like, if you start out all of a sudden just introducing into your diet and you don't get that much fiber normally. And I think also the combinations of things. Like, I've noticed if I do it with a lot of high-carb foods, like rice or something, that's when I get the gas.
Yeah.
You know, like, that's just like a thing, something I've noticed. So I try to do it like lower carb stuff. It's kind of a weird thing to have to think about, but I've like, if I have the soup that I mentioned, it doesn't really have like a high carb amount and I don't really get gassy. I just kind of enjoy it and going about my life. But if I have like a bunch of rice with it, I feel like there's a combination, at least in my body, that happens. It's just like bloated. And
I wonder if, like, you got to figure that this sort of turns people off from trying to eat healthy because it's very American to go all in on something out of nowhere. So people are like, oh, new year, new me, or whatever. Like, I'm going to start eating vegetables, and they eat half a head of cabbage and want to die. And they're like, well, I'm never doing that again.
Yeah, it's true.
Start
slow.
Yeah,
you definitely need to incorporate it slowly.
Yeah.
Like, figure out the things that you like. It is a very versatile thing. I mean, you can put it in quiches. Like, there's so many possibilities for broccoli and I think vegetables in general, but broccoli is just so yummy.
I think that cooked broccoli has a very mild flavor. Yeah. And so you can incorporate it into a lot of things. It's so strange, though. I cannot abide raw broccoli.
I've tried, like, on those trays that people put out, you know, and they have, like, the dressing, and it's like, okay, I'll do it. You know, but it's just, I don't know, something about it just doesn't feel as satisfying to me.
It's so gnarly, I think.
It's gnarly?
In or my that, opinion. You know, like... Raw broccoli is real nar-nar.
Nar-nar.
Awesome. Jules, thank you so much for this education in Icelandic culture. This is awesome. I know so
My
much
pleasure.
More about now, and I'm glad that we could bond over broccoli. Not many people can say that.
No, that is true. Thank you, Catherine, for helping me learn about broccoli, because there's a whole lot that I didn't know.
My pleasure.
Honestly, like, you know, I now I feel like I'm ready for trivia on broccoli. So
yes.
That's really awesome.
You could kill a bar trivia night about produce. Are you All Things Iceland on all the platforms?
Yes. I mean, I technically am on Twitter, but I don't really use it a lot. And that's just Jules Chambers. So Instagram, YouTube, and just like the podcast is all things Iceland. And Facebook.
Okay, perfect. Thank you so much.
All by myself, with this great big world before me, but it's all for someone else. I've tried and tried again to let you know just where my heart is, to tell the truth and not pretend. All I needed was to get away, just to realize that I was meant to stay. Where the mountains sing through the screams of seagulls, where the whales can't live 'cause they're gentle people in my heart.
Hey everybody, thank you for listening. The show is brought to you by Wunderquark. It's a dairy product that's super popular in Europe and Central Asia. And though it is technically a soft cheese, it more closely resembles a really thick yogurt. You can eat quark plain. I think it makes a great breakfast because it's super filling and it has up to 24 grams of protein in every 8 ounces. And it doesn't separate when it gets hot, so you can use it in cooking and baking too. A brand called Wunder is bringing quark to the US, so if you would like to try it, go to wundercreamery.com and enter code SMARTMOUTH for 15% off on your first order. That's wundercreamery.com, W-U-N-D-E-R creamery, and use code SMARTMOUTH. The sources for this week's episode are the USDA, Indiana Public Media, Nature.com, Colorado State University, the New World Encyclopedia, and Texas A&M University. You can find links to all the sources in the show notes and at smartmouthpodcast.com. Join me on Instagram at smartmouthpodcast. The Patreon is at patreon.com/smartmouthpodcast, and the newsletter is at smartmouth.substack.com. SmartMouth is a production of Table Cakes, a woman-owned Los Angeles-based podcast company. SmartMouth is hosted and produced by me, Catherine Spires, and engineered by Mika Grimm. Check out all of our shows at tablecakes.com.
A Table Cakes production.